Hello, you multi-mummers. I'll start that again so I can get it right. Hello, you multi-mummers. Ralph here with Whisky Review 395. Is it six? Oh my goodness, it's 396. And thank you to Barry Dons for that malt mention, introducing this rye review. Second one in the series of three. We've already reviewed Pikesville in Whisky Review 395. And we will be reviewing that High West rye whiskey in 396.7. Yes. I need my vitamin tablets. But in the meantime, I'll just have to satisfy myself with a little glass of this 25-year-old Rittenhouse rye. Oh, what a big age for a rye. There are very few ryes in the market that are actually this old. It tends to be the case that we associate age with quality. It's certainly the case with Scotch whisky, particularly single malts. But does it work for other spirits? Well, we certainly notice it working in a number of bourbons if the quality of the barrel's right. But let's bear in mind, rye is such a different grain to either wheat, barley, or corn. It's so much more intense. And it doesn't necessarily equate that it will age as successfully as malted barley does. However, if we're going to find out, this is probably a good bottle to start with. Produced by Heaven Hill. Well, they tend to know what they're doing, and in Kentucky. And of course, it's all really all about the age of this rye. As soon as you put your nose in the glass, what strikes one is how intensely voluminous the nose is. There's a lot going on. It's not subtle after 25 years. It's really quite intense. The phenolic nature of the rye and the aromatic nature of the rye really hasn't toned down over the years. There's quite a rich woody spiciness going on. It's very concentrated with loads of beeswax, furniture polish, armchairs, leather, those complex flavour notes that you tend to smell but never taste, and is usually accompanies older spirits. Anyway, we'll kick off with the smell first of all. It really takes a while to get used to the initial almost glue-like solventy clout of flavour coming off here. It really wouldn't be fair to judge or make an appraisal of this whiskey too early on. You need to spend time with it. Small glasses, not too much. Don't sicken yourself, because it really is heavily flavoured. And just persevere and gradually get to know it. What I'm noticing in the nose is mentholated wood honey, bitter rye grain, an intensely strong nose of wood spices and tannin, turmeric, orange pekoe tea, horseradish sauce, green ginger, walnuts, creosote tar, burnt wood, and wood polish. So, but as you can appreciate, this ain't no shrinking violet. Taste-wise, oh, you can't add too much water, by the way. It goes from intense to over-dilute very quickly. When you add water, it seems to kill off the development and the finish in particular. For such an intense arrival of flavour, this is a surprisingly delicate spirit. Taste-wise, quite rich, complex, but also there's quite a lot of kind of solvent, pleasant solventy notes about it. A rye malt arrival, as one would expect, develops bitter wood and treacle. So there's this bitter treacle note. Wood heavy, sour bitter fruits, unripe cherries, crab apple, liniment, solvent, and sticking plasters. Am I making this sound attractive? I don't mean to be giving you descriptors that make this sound absolutely awful, because it's not really the case. It's challenging, that's for sure. This is actually, in many ways, it's got the most unsettling character of some of these obscure old East Highland malts like Northport and Lochside. One will find over time that, in fact, the 25 years in wood has allowed the cask to slowly creep up and overwhelm the spirit, particularly in the development into the finish. It is very wood bitter and tanniny. In fact, it would have been probably better bottled at 20 years old. So we have a rye here in which probably there's too much conversation, if you know what I mean, coming from the cask. But not all is lost, and I'll come back to that shortly. I'll conclude with the finish of the flavour, which spent matches, cold vanilla cream, and a lot of bitter wood. Quite aromatic bitter wood, but quite bitter all the same. Interesting stuff. It isn't a connoisseur's dream. This is not a rye where the 25 years have significantly upped the quality. It's just a different variant of a perfectly good rye experience that you could get with a younger bottle. And in fact, I'm going to demonstrate to you. If you have an old rye, it applies to any spirit. So long as you're kind of careful and don't add too much. If the cask is too dominant, if there's too much tannins and wood bitters and wood sap, if you get a younger but very similar whiskey, and just add a drop, not a lot, just a drop, what you will find is, given 5 or 10 minutes, the rye content will re-exert itself against the dominance of the cask, and you can recover a certain balance in the whiskey that might otherwise have been lost. And it's worth considering, because all bottles of whiskey, no matter whether it be rye, bourbon or scotch, they can cost a fortune. They ain't cheap. And when you actually break down the cost of the bottle as to how many hours you have to work to earn that money, then it puts it into perspective, doesn't it? Anyway, let's clock up a mark here for this. It's a rye mark. It's a rye mark. It couldn't be an anything else mark. Here we are. I'm going to be kind, because there's so few aged ryes out there, really aged ryes. They're not hugely expensive, although they are costly. They're certainly an interesting experience. I could give it an 87 out of 100. But particularly for the complexity in the arrival and initial development, which can only happen gradually over time to such an intensely flavoured grain spirit, I'm going to give this 88 out of 100, and it's a rye mark. Now, let's conclude. Rye is rather an interesting grain. It tends to grow in the northern latitude, where winters are long and summers are wet. It's a kind of fairly tough grass that grows about 4 foot high. And there's quite a number of varieties of rye, more than you would expect. Very few are actually cultivated commercially. But rye it's experiencing a bit of a renaissance at the moment, particularly in Canada, but also in America, where you've got some little small batch things going on, some of which are extortionately expensive, and frankly, I wouldn't waste my money. I reckon if you want to start with rye, Alberta Premium is a very good place to start for a nice, balanced, all-round rye moment. But it's ryes like these, when you want to kind of develop a more of a rye awareness, these big character ryes, which they're not easy access, believe me, they're not, but they're interesting. And as a mixer for a more sophisticated long drinker cocktail, you just can't go wrong. One thing's for sure, a nose like this, which is getting increasingly honeyed, by the way, it's interesting stuff. And if you're particularly if you're in a whiskey tasting club, then it's an interesting one to share around rather than sacrificed to the full cost of a bottle. This, incidentally, is barrel number 27, bottle number 39. So it's giving you a point of reference. What I'm reviewing is from a single barrel, number 27. Bottled at 50%, so 100 proof, by the way. Strong stuff. So it does need the water, but watch you don't overwater it or you will kill the experience. And we wouldn't want that, would we? Anyway, let's kill this vlog by concluding it, and I hope you'll join me shortly for whiskey review thingamabob. Yes, 397. That's what it'll be. Will it? Yes, it will. In which I will be reviewing High West, which is an interesting rye, very much a new generation rye. But you'll find out soon enough if you join me. Thanks for watching. See you soon.